Hi there, everyone. This is Brayden and Tally with the Voice of My Beloved podcast. And we have been experiencing technical difficulties here, which is why we had a funny little excerpt up on the podcast on SoundCloud for a couple days. But we are here to fix it. We're doing a full-length podcast right now. We actually sent our last podcast equipment that we have been using. We've sent that over to Israel for the Joshua and Caleb report. They're going to be using it over there. So we've kind of graduated. It's gotten a promotion. It's landed in Israel at this point.
Yes.
And so we're in the process of transitioning to new podcast equipment. So in the midst of that, we've made a little blip. And now we're fixing it. And we're going to have the real podcast up now. So we're going to move on here. And try to get over our technical challenges here, right?
Yes. We're super excited about our subject today.
Yeah, we are. We are super excited. We're talking about the involvement of parents in this whole process. Okay, so last week we talked about betrothal. And what is betrothal? What does it look like? And it has a lot to do with parental authority involvement in our lives. And so we kind of wanted to just break that down a little bit today and just talk about what that looks like as far as this whole process goes. And I know a couple weeks ago we talked about turning the hearts of the fathers to the sons and the sons to the fathers, which is a very related topic. But we're going to talk more kind of specifically.
Yeah, that previous podcast on turning the hearts of the fathers to the children, we focused on the fathers. And today we're going to talk about the sons turning their hearts to the fathers and the daughters as well, for sure. Mm-hmm. And this is so key. It's so key in these end times, because the opposite of that is what we're seeing in our culture, where there's a lack of respect, a lack of honor for a generation that's gone before. And Tally and I want to be a voice calling you to the blessing. We mm-hmm. want to see you walk in blessing. And we've experienced this. And so, you know, when you talk to someone, I encourage you to learn from their experiences. And so that's what we hope to encourage you in today, is that we've experienced a blessing as we've sought to walk this out. We've not done it perfectly, for sure, but we've experienced a blessing as we've sought to walk this out, the first commandment with promise.
Yeah. So it's good. It's not the easy road, right?
Right.
This is not the path of least resistance by any means. And we know that we're talking to all kinds of situations out there. And so, you know, there's all kinds of things with generational things and things that I'm sure that you all are dealing with your parents. But you know what? God is bigger. And we just want to encourage you in that. You know, God is bigger than any problem that's there, than any hurt, than any wall that's been put up in this relationship. And so we just, our encouragement today is to just take the next step in pursuing a relationship with your parents, pursuing honor and honoring path, what that looks like in your life, just crying out to God. I mean, this is a work of the Holy Spirit again, you know, and we're not here to give you a method or talk about how great we are and our or anything like that. But we want to just encourage you to continue to go forward in what God's called you to. He's called you to this place of honor. And like Brayden said, there's great, great blessing in it.
Yes, and we're talking about this overall picture of honor, but also directly how it relates to preparing for marriage. Now, this road of honor is going to be something you want to develop and, you know, mature in all of your teen years, but really culminating to this point where you are welcoming your parents' involvement in pursuing a marriage partner. Mm-hmm. And we can see an example of that with Abraham. You know, Abraham sends his servant to go find a wife for his son Isaac. And so it's a great, great story there. Just a good biblical reference to a parent being involved in finding his child mm-hmm. Spouse.
Yeah. Which it's kind of interesting, because I believe about 100 years ago, this was pretty common practice. The parents were expected to be involved in this mm-hmm. decision. It's really only in the recent years that we've kind of walked away from that. But even today, it's still, you know, there are people that still will try to go to the Father and kind of do that kind of tradition or whatever. I wanted to tell a funny story because my dad is just great, and he's kind of, you know, my dad's an introvert. He's you know, he gets kind of nervous every once in a while when he's talking to people. He's great. My mom is total opposite. She'll talk to anyone. But my dad, when he was pursuing my mom, they had been dating for a couple weeks or something like that. And he went and sat down to eat with my mom's dad, who had just recently gotten remarried to a lady that was my dad's age. And so my dad and mom are sitting down with her dad, and my dad looks at him and he says, "Well, Mr. Frank, I was just wanting to ask permission if I could marry your wife." and so the...
As soon as he said it, he realized he had made a mistake.
Yeah, he realized pretty quickly that he made this mistake, but it was pretty funny.
So people still do that.
People still do it. You know,
ask the father for permission to marry their daughter.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So it's this is something that was a big part of Brayden and I's story. You know, and I just want to tell a little bit about practically speaking what this looked like in my life. I grew up with a really good relationship with my parents. And as far as, you know, the idea of them being involved in choosing a spouse, I don't know that I really thought about it that much growing up. But I started realizing it more in my early 20s, just how important their role was in my life. And so, you know, in my parents are not really big, like, authoritative commanders. Mm-hmm. And so in my case, I had to really, you know, they weren't going to sit me down and tell me this is what you have to do.
You had to invite it.
Yeah, it was an invitation that I had to kind of have, and really a desire that my own heart had to be in a place where I was...
Teachable.
Where I was teachable, yeah, where I was inviting their blessing and their input in my life. And so I had been in New York City for several years and came back home, and not knowing what to do, started going to school for nursing. Well, in my first semester of nursing, I went to Israel for the first time. And that's when I had like a big life change. I came back home and I was like, I've got to get back to Israel. I started getting a vision for being a mother and a wife, and just the whole like doing everything at home and homeschooling and reading Nancy Campbell above Ruby's. And I'm like, this is the life I want. I want like this pure, like, you know, this purity and everything. And so I'm sitting here going, I'm talking to my parents and I'm like, you know, I don't see how nursing school is going to get me on a path to Israel, to being a wife, being a mother. And my parents loved that I was excited about these things, but they just really encouraged me. We really think you need to pursue something that we don't know if that's going to happen for you. We don't know what it's going to look like. We want you to pursue something that you could get a job with or whatever. And so my little artsy self went to nursing school and pursued a degree, and thought, man, this is not taking me towards my goal at all. This is totally counterproductive. And in my brain, in the natural, you would have looked at that and said, she's crazy for doing that. This is not going to get her to where she wants to go. But because God is in control and He has anointed my parents to speak into my life, I submitted myself to my parents' desires, and I went to school for nursing. And I was one semester away from a degree when Brayden came and pursued me. And so this all took place in my parents' blessing. And I believe that God saw that heart of wanting to be submitted, wanting His will, and He blessed. There was a blessing that came with that. And so it doesn't always make sense, you know, your parents' advice or what they tell you to do even, or and it's not that you have to, you know, we're not saying do everything they command you to and think just like they do or anything like that. But
it has to do with the spirit, with the attitude that you approach them with.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And really just knowing God and what he's calling you to do and how to relate to your parents. Yeah. As well. So.
Yeah, I love this passage here in Ephesians 6, verse 1. It says, "Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right." You want to do something right? Listen to your parents. Honor them. It says, "Honor your father and mother, which is the first commandment with promise, that it may be well with you and you may live long on the earth." So this commandment has direct relationship to your prospering in this life, in your walk in this world. And so as you honor your parents, there's a blessing, a divine blessing. It's just like a funnel to heaven. You're just funneling in blessings into your life. And this is the path you want to choose. That word honor there from the Ten Commandments, honor your father and mother, it's the Hebrew word kabed. And so this is the Hebrew word that actually, kabed in Hebrew also means heavy. And so when the scripture is saying honor your father and mother, it's saying make weighty their role in your life. And so that's the spirit that we're really seeking to encourage for younger people, is to say, yes, mom and dad, you have a place in my life. I'm going to give weight to your role. And that's what the scripture, this is what this commandment is encouraging us to do, is to give them that place, to as Tally did in her relationship with her mom and dad, to invite that role. And that's, you know, honor is something that, you know, it doesn't work really well when you have to demand it. But you know what, as a child, I just welcome you to say, mom and dad, I want your input in my life. I want you to speak into my life, because I believe that is going to be a path of blessing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And you know, one of the things I noticed, I was reading through this book talking about how the Bible validates so many different scientific studies that have been done in the world. And one of them is that they were going around and checking life expectancies in different cultures. And when cultures where there was a honoring attitude towards elders, towards parents, they have much longer life expectancies. I mean, many of you probably recognize that Orientals live a lot longer than other people groups. And these Orientals have a really strong value on honoring their elders. Mm-hmm. And so this is, it was just interesting, you know, looking at the different life expectancies in these different cultures and seeing how, wow, the Bible is right. Mm-hmm. If you honor your parents, you're going to live long. You're going to have a prosperous life in this world.
Yeah, and I don't know if I've had some friends that are Korean that follow this out pretty rigidly. It's amazing what is expected. The parents are like the king and queen, and like the children basically. I mean, an American would look at this, what a Korean person does for their parents, as abusive, like they are meant, like they're supposed to invite their parents to live with them in the house. The parents demand, I mean, I've heard there's some really crazy stories. I had a Korean friend that, which brings me to my next thing that I just wanted to touch on a little bit was just how the importance of the anointing and the parent's role in your life is an anointed position. There's an anointing there where God's called you to honor them. And so there's an anointing, a God-given anointing that he's placed on your parents' lives. And so I just want to look at David and Saul, for instance, and Brayden talks about this a lot. Do you want to talk about that? Just the importance of recognizing the anointing.
Yeah. It's interesting. You look in the Bible at the first mention of something, and this is oftentimes where you get some key elements of what the Bible's talking about when you go back to the first mention of a particular thing. And so actually the first mention of a person being demonically oppressed is Saul. And we look at where that began. It's where he rebelled against God. And so we look back and we see Samuel, he comes at Saul and he says, rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft. And so the extreme opposite of honor is rebellion. And so we see Saul, he did not honor God, but he rebelled against him. And this actually brought in a witchcraft into his life, a demonic oppression into Saul's life. and he's tormented by this thing. And I have seen firsthand how children, seemingly with good reasons, going against their parents, mm-hmm. coming against them. But then there's an open door for demonic activity. And I look at those children down the line, 4 or 5 years from that moment where they made that choice to, and we're not saying there are certain situations where, yes, there is legitimate reason to separate yourself from an abusive situation. But overall, we're trying to address a spirit that is very pervasive in our society where people are dishonoring and just kind of just casting aside any input from their parents or an older generation. Mm-hmm. And that's what we're addressing here. Mm-hmm. And this is where Saul, he opened himself up to this demonic influence and he's tormented. And so I've seen this where children have opened their hearts up to this demonic influence and they're tormented and they're led down this path of really ever increasing rebellion and rebellion against the word of God, rebellion against their parents and the wisdom that they offer. And so this is something very serious. And so with Saul and David, we see this, that David's coming in and he's actually being yielded. He's yielding himself mm-hmm. to, and he's wanting to honor who he says, this person has been anointed king of Israel. So he's mm-hmm. going to honor that and walk through this whole process.
Yeah.
But then God, in his perfect timing, exalts David to be the king.
Yeah. And that's what I just wanted to point out with David is that Saul had an anointing in Israel. I mean, mm-hmm. he was an anointed leader mm-hmm. and David had to recognize that. He recognized and he didn't rebel against that. David had every right to give Saul a what for and mm-hmm. and to even pray that God would bring judgment on Saul and that, that David could teach him a thing or two. And I think
talk about abuse. I mean, he got a spear thrown at him.
Throwing spears at him, right? Running for his life from this guy. I think that that's where we have to really know where our heart is, because I think that there are some rough situations out there with parents and stuff. There are abusive situations, and there is a need to distance yourself. To walk away from that, to separate yourself from that, and even get help, and get support. I think that the place that I'd really ask you to really test yourself with your heart is when you're wanting to teach them a lesson, you're wanting them to pay for what they've done to you, you're wanting to see them, be judged and be harshly dealt with. I think that's the place where we really need to understand that, we should really have the fear of God when we start having an attitude like that towards our parents. Because I think that place of anointing is a place that is a spot that you can't, it's not something that God gives and takes away. It's not like, well, they're anointed if they're good parents. If they're bad parents, they're not anointed. There's an anointing that falls on them despite everything. And so you really have to recognize, okay, God, how can I relate to my parents in a way that is honoring and recognizing the anointing that they have? Mm-hmm. And a lot of times I think that if you recognize that position that your parents have, it almost causes them to rise up to maybe a greater level at times.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Because I think a lot of today the culture is total disrespect towards parents. And so there's no striving to even be honorable
mm-hmm.
because they don't care about me anyways, mm-hmm. So I'm not going to even try to speak into my children's lives and stuff. So I think when you make a heart change and say, I'm not going to go with the culture here. I want you parents to know, I really want to honor you. I think that causes a heart change in the parents as mm-hmm. well. and I just it's as a parent, now I'm in this place where I'm a parent too. It's a very weighty thing for me to think about because my children are commanded to honor me despite the way I act, despite the way I treat them or anything. And that should be very weighty for me, mm-hmm. That I want to handle this place, this position very well. I want to handle it in a place that, you know, I'm being very responsible with the way that, I'm treating my children, the way that I'm relating to them and stuff.
Yeah. Yeah, I think too, just as the foundation of our whole heart in this podcast is to hear the voice of your beloved. So as you're hearing us speak, I pray that you're able to hear this call to blessing. Mm-hmm. We want you to hear the voice of Yeshua saying, rise up, my son, rise up, my daughter, to this place of blessing and be a part of preparing the way of the Lord, which is a part of that is the children turning their hearts to their parents. Mm-hmm. And this is all a part of this anointing. Mm-hmm. And I just want to encourage you that in discipleship to Yeshua, we want to follow him, and he is such a perfect example of yielding his life to his father's will. Mm-hmm. And, you know, he had a perfect father, you know, so it's a different kind of deal here, but yet the spirit of it is what we're saying. The spirit of Yeshua's life was, I'm yielding to my heavenly father's will for my life, even if it costs me at some points. Mm-hmm. And I don't want to, you know, he was so interested in his own personal gain, in his own personal, he was just yielded to the Father. Mm-hmm. And he was humble. You know, the scripture says that even Yeshua, he welcomed people to come learn of him, how humble he was. Come unto me, learn how humble I am. And I'm meek and lowly in heart. Mm-hmm. And this is something he wants us. If you're a disciple of Yeshua, he wants you to learn from him humility. Mm-hmm. And this attitude of respect and honor towards your elders and parents, this cultivates humility in your life, and there's a blessing that comes with that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. I also want to encourage, you know, that we are, I believe that the word also encourages us to look at, to be a fruit inspector. That's what I've heard, right? Mm-hmm. To be a fruit inspector, to look at good and bad fruit. And your parents are going to have good and bad fruit. And you have to inspect that. You have to know, you have to look at those things. But there's got, in, like Braden said, as if you do that in a place of humility and understanding, I believe that's the right place to do it, because we can't look at our parents and just say, okay, we need to paint over everything in our parents' lives as perfect and look, you know, because the thing is, we have to deal with the generational things as well, right? And it talks about the generational sins that get passed down. And those are the things that we need to inspect and see, what are our parents walking in? What are our grandparents? What have they walked in? What is the fruit of their lives? And we have to look and say, okay, there's some bad fruit here. And I have to deal with that. You know, I have to be part of the generation saying, I'm going to stop that here and now. But that doesn't mean that you're supposed to walk in some sort of like a harsh judgment towards your parents. But I do believe that you should, you know, have a heart of I'm going to, I want to pass down good fruit to my, right, to my children, the good fruit that I've received, and be grateful for that. Look for the good fruit in your parents and really concentrate on those things, right, and really highlight those
things.
Yeah,
the Thessalonians, test all things, hold fast to what is good.
Yes.
Right? You don't want to be holding fast to bad things. I mean, people can just like nurse a bad experience they had and just like that be their little friend. They just want to cultivate and just, you know, develop a relationship with. But no, hold fast to what is good. Mm-hmm. If you've, you know, if your parents have good things, I'm sure there's some good things, some good qualities in your parents. Mm-hmm. Hold fast to that. Mm-hmm. You want to pass that on to the next generation. If there's bad qualities, then, you know, then don't take that on, you know, but take on the good, hold fast to what is good.
Yeah. Yeah. And also just, I think understanding is a big thing, and just understanding, I know for me over the years, just recognizing my parents have fought, they have gained ground in their life. They've gained so much ground, and I am so appreciative of the ground that they have taken, that I get to experience the fruit of that, of the battles that they've fought, and being grateful for that. And you know, of course there's going to be blind spots here and there, you know, but be focus on the good.
Yeah. Can you summarize maybe that? The attitude that we're aiming for is an attitude of gratefulness, mm-hmm, as compared to an attitude of critical spirit, mm-hmm, you know. But as we relate to our parents, I'm thankful for all that you did for me, mm-hmm, all that you've sown into my life. Mm-hmm. I want to just touch a little bit here on the Rechabites. You may have heard of them. It's in Jeremiah chapter 35, but I'll just summarize the story. God tells Jeremiah, go to these Rechabites and put wine before them and ask them to drink it. And so he brings them in and he asks them to drink this wine. They say, no, our father told us not to drink wine. And Jeremiah is kind of astounded at this because the people of Israel, they're not relating to their father God this way. But yet these children of Jonadab, the Rechabites, mm-hmm. they are honoring their father's command. That's not really even connected to a biblical command. Mm-hmm. But yet his father, who knows? He may have had an experience where he saw wine abused. And so he's telling his sons, you know, we want to stay away from this substance because for whatever reason, we don't know, maybe God spoke to him and said, this is something I want you to pass on to your children. Mm-hmm. And so a young person today might go, Dad, the Bible doesn't say that. You know, the Bible doesn't say you can't smoke cigarettes. The Bible doesn't say whatever, you name it. And but yet the father says, no, culturally, child, this is what I want you to abide by as you're in my home. And these Rechabites demonstrate that in such an amazing way. Mm-hmm. They're going to embrace what their father asked them to do. Yeah. And then it says that they're blessed for that. It says, Jonadab, the son of Rehav, shall not lack a man to stand before me forever. Mm-hmm. He gets this incredible blessing.
It's a nice blessing.
Yeah, because he's honoring his father's command. And I just want to encourage young people out there to have that mindset, you know, to humbly accept, especially if you're living in your parents' home, you know, to accept even the traditions or the way that scripture is played out in your home, honor that. Mm-hmm. And don't have a proud spirit saying, well, where does the Bible say that? You know, because the sons of Rechab, they could have said, well, where does the Bible say you can't drink wine? You know, but no, they honored what their father told them to do. Mm-hmm. And they were greatly blessed because of it. So mm-hmm. we want to encourage that attitude. Mm-hmm. And we want to encourage you to go countercultural, yeah. go the opposite direction that the culture is going of just casting off any input from the elders. You know, the new authority in our culture is Google. You know, he knows everything. So why do you need your parents to speak into your life when Google knows? No, experience matters. And more than that, more than even the practical aspects, there's a spiritual truth here. There's a spiritual blessing mm-hmm. that comes into your life as you have a right attitude yeah. towards your parents.
Yeah, and this is something that takes cultivation over years so that, you know, this is something that you need to pursue. It's not something you can all of a sudden, you know, we're talking about here getting married, and we're not saying like you can have a bad relationship with your parents and all of a sudden you want to invite them into this whole process of betrothal and stuff. This is something you have to cultivate and prepare yourself for. So I just wanted to say the blessings of having your parents be involved in this whole decision. It creates a lot of unity and blessing as you get ready for a wedding. Everyone's behind you. Everyone's supporting you. You've got the support of all the parents. It's huge. It makes for a very happy wedding where everyone is for you. You're not doing this on your own. You're not having to beg your parents to do stuff. They are like excited about it. They're going for this with you. And it sets up a good foundation for your marriage.
They're able to support you into the marriage.
Exactly. Yeah. And they see the invitation of, we want your input. And so if you do that right at the start of a marriage, wow, that's going to really set you on a good track mm-hmm. because they're going to feel that invitation. Like, and that's a fear and trembling thing, you know, that they want to speak into your life. Like they want to have a say in your life, and the invitation is a big deal. And so, and that's what you want as a new couple. You're going to want that wisdom being spoken into your life. And then also, it's really a good setup for if you have marriage problems down the road. If there's things that you have a struggle with your husband or with your wife or whatever, you can go to your parents knowing that there's a safe place. They helped you make this decision. They sought God about this. They got direction, and you all want to see the success of this marriage. This isn't like you're struggling in your marriage. You go to your parents and they're like, well, you picked him out. We didn't like him to begin with. You know, it's like, it's not a setup for that. This is like this is setting you up for the blessing for the rest of your life. This is a lifelong blessing involving them in this process. So yeah, we bless you to pursue the path of blessing, and yeah, go think about your parents for a little bit. Think about something good about each one of them, and I encourage you to just go to them this week. I don't care how old you are, how young you are. Think about something good about your parents, and I want you to go to your parents, to your mom, to your dad, and tell them that thing that you recognize in them, that thing that you want to see in your life, something, a good quality that they have embraced that you want to see. And yeah, go and be a blessing. We'll see you next week. We're going to sign off. Many blessings.